Welcome to the Itnig podcast. My name is Sindre Hopland. I'm with Itnig. Today we have the first podcast of 2017, and that's why we're going to discuss Barcelona and the tech industry in the city. Because it's natural, we're at the beginning of the year, and there's a lot of good things coming ahead. There's already a bunch of things happening in 2017 already, but we have with us two guys, two smart guys, as always, to discuss the new year. First, Scott Mackin, editor of Barcino, and founder and CEO of Bourbon Creative. Thank you for coming.
Well, thanks for having me. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. And on the other side, we have a director of 4 years for now, and also the CEO of Mobile World Congress, Aleix Valls. Thank you for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Pleasure, pleasure. So, as I said, amazing things are happening in the city's tech community, and you know, founders are building amazing products. More established startups are getting funded. We're seeing bigger and bigger rounds, and we're attracting a lot of great talent from abroad. And now, the highlight of the year, 4 years from now, is coming up. I guess you're in the middle of this. It's a hectic time for you, Aleix, mm-hmm. I guess. And just starting there, because that's like the next big thing in Barcelona right now, if no surprises comes up, you know. This is like the big thing every year, but how can we get the 4 years from now vibe to stick the whole year? What do you think, Aleix?
I think this year we are going to celebrate the fourth edition of 4 years from now. That is mandatory to do a celebration, no? Because in our name we force ourselves that every 4 years we need to do something special. Right. And I think that the most special thing for this year is that what we see at the next edition in next February of 4 years from now is that we will have a lot of startups and a lot of companies, traditional ones if you want, that they are not belonging to the tech sector anymore.
Right.
I mean, digital transformation, and especially startups that we see here also in Barcelona, they are doing a pivot to just not be a B2C startups anymore. And a lot of startups are focusing business models on the B2B space because corporates are looking for innovation, are looking for digital solutions. And I think that every time it's more and more understood by the corporate side that they cannot do it in-house. They need to look for outside, for partnership, and partnership with companies that they are not used to. Mm-hmm. They're not traditional, if you want, ICT suppliers of the big corporates. And I think that 4 years from now, this year, we will see a change between the interaction of the startups with more B2B business models and a lot of corporates showing up there looking for partners or for solutions that are coming from, if you want, the non-traditional ICT suppliers of the corporate guys.
Exactly. So in some ways, because I've been feeling like the 4 years from now has been like the startup, young, tech, vibrant community, and then you have the Mobile World Congress, which is more corporate B2B. Mm-hmm. So are they merging somehow in some ways, or how do you?
I don't think that they are merging. They are complementary products or the complementary programs.
Yeah.
I mean, we will keep always focusing that the hero and the relevant guy at 4 years from now always will be the startup, because it's the way that we designed that product from the really beginning. But we will see is that more corporates, more responsible of partnership programs, more responsible of innovation guys in the corporate side are going to show up there, looking for the right solutions that they are doing. That means that we are even more complementary to what is going on at Mobile World Congress.
Exactly.
That is terminals, is backends for networks, is big guys selling big equipment and new generations of networks. But we have, if you want, this fresh new innovation coming from the startup world that every time more and more is not just these weird young guys doing weird things under the radar.
Right.
If not anymore, is a guys that we need to talk with, and is a guy that we need to partnership with.
Right.
And that
right.
I think is a big step that we see in the last 4 years.
Exactly. And and Scott, every year before 4 years from now, you can go into Google Analytics and see the Barcino blog without mentioning numbers. It's spiking, you know.
Yeah.
It's spiking.
This is definitely our busiest season. The Mobile World Congress 4 years from now coming here, all eyes in the tech and startup world are on Barcelona. We've been fortunate enough to witness the growth of 4 years from now. You know, this is the fourth edition, so we are coming up 4 years later, which is fantastic. The first year was really kind of a Spain, more Spanish Spanish audience, Spanish startups, kind of a who's who, but of Spain, it was kind of a seeing old friends from Madrid coming in, and it was very friendly to the now, which is kind of this, you know, global, let's say, or at least European kind of focal point of the year. And I agree with what you said. I think corporations are learning. They're not moving fast enough internally. They need to create avenues for these startups, these innovations, these technologies to either come up through acquisition or at least even through, you know, a sales product. So they're developing their own internal silos, CIOs, like, you know, chief innovation officer to really try and speed up the implementation of these external technologies into their corporations. Otherwise, they're going to die. You know, and Gartner Research, Forrester Research, even Startup Bootcamp just released a report last week saying that corporates are realizing they're too slow and they're gonna cease to exist if they don't move faster. They don't change their ways. So I think 4 years from now offers kind of a an avenue for that. But we definitely back to your original point. We definitely see a huge spike this time of year.
But how can we keep it? Is it possible even to keep this pressure so high all year round? Do you think?
Certainly, I think I think as long as we're keeping the discussion and the conversation strong, the investment rounds, the growth, if we can highlight some of these stories, and if we can create some of these synergies and share that news, it's going to be helpful to keep a spotlight on Barcelona throughout the year. That's actually part of the reason that Mobile World Capital Barcelona was founded, right? Exactly. To keep that momentum all year round. So, I mean, maybe Aleix has some more insights into what's happening.
I guess, because we're trying to build hubs here, right? I guess all kind of cities around Europe are trying to become a hub for some kind of industry in tech. And I guess Barcelona has always been the e-commerce center and some other kind of hubs for other kind of industries as well, but what are we trying to specialize in, Aleix?
I think my vision, or the vision that we share in our team, is that in the next 4 or 5 years it's going to be a dramatic loop in some 4 or 5 communities or hubs around cities in Europe. I mean, the Silicon Valley, or the European version of Silicon Valley, is going to be 4 or 5 hubs, verticalized in several, 1-2 sectors. I don't know if sectors technologies, sectors/slash technology.
Yeah.
Nowadays, I think Barcelona, it depends how type of report you look for, it will be the 5th. London ahead, you have after that Berlin, Paris, Amsterdam, and Barcelona is there, maybe Madrid later. But the question is that nowadays, when you see the KPIs of that ecosystems, depends on the report, things change. That means that there is not a dramatic gap between each of them. What I see is that it's going to happen something at the Champions League. It's going to be like 5 cities that, yes or not, they are going to fight to be on the final, and it will be the others that, they are lucky enough, they will be at the semifinals. And how that is going to happen? Because corporates are going to enter into the game. That will not be anymore a game of startups and investors. Corporates are going to jump into the stage, and now we are going to see startups B2B business model base with big revenues, not just about millions of active users.
Right.
It's about millions in revenue of your P&L, and that will take the startups to a next level. More easy to be able to engage with new type of capital, not just for the classical VC that is more used to B2C business models, that they are looking for more stable and more, if you want, sustainable revenues models, where they feel more comfortable to enter with. That will take these 5 cities to the next level. London on the fintech, but there is a big question mark about what is going to happen with the Brexit thing. And especially because when you look at the type of founders that London has nowadays, almost 60% are coming from abroad. If to go to London and hire talent to London, it became more difficult, that will decrease the number of talent that will choose the city as a place to start a business. That will create, if you want, an opportunity for Barcelona to be able to capture that. Berlin is the opposite side. In Berlin, you see that almost 60-70% of the founders, they are Germans. They are more investing in a national culture to become an entrepreneur. And you have Rocket Internet that has been the one who lead the building of the ecosystem.
Right.
We are missing this type of Rocket Internet approach. I don't say copycats, I say the ones who are able to make that exit. But when you see the amazing projects like Let Go, different type of projects that we have already here in Barcelona raising money as crazy, we will see in the next 2-3 years this raising starts, if they are not unicorns close to, that will take us to the next level. That is my thought, my vision, what is going to happen on the, if you I can say in the next 4 years.
Yeah.
And I think is what Barcelona needs to be focused.
Yeah, exactly.
Is the strategy that Barcelona needs to follow to be sure that we became the Barcelona football club, yeah. Not just on the football space, on the soccer space, also on the digital side.
Yeah. Sure. No, definitely.
And you're nodding. I guess you're agreeing. But like the startup we have now, the biggest companies that are like raising the biggest rounds and by some measures having the most success, it's consumer facing products. So Scott, can you think of any like B2B companies that are like up and coming? Or
you know, there was one that just made a big splash in the past few weeks. It's Travel Perk. I think that they have a very, very interesting business model into a yet untapped B2B space that is still very traditional. It's still very fragmented. It's still very analog. So essentially Travel Perk, what they're doing is they're trying to disrupt business travel, mm-hmm. right? So the guys who are traveling, you know, 180 days out of the year, they're right. living out of a suitcase in hotels. I mean, I think they're more focusing on some of the smaller and medium-sized businesses, not corporate yet or enterprise yet. But I mean, that's still a, you know, I don't know, maybe $50 billion market. If you think about all the travel that's happening around the world and how they do it, it's usually done through, you know, I don't know, office managers or even the sales guys themselves.
Yeah.
I mean, they're trying to bring a solution that's kind of a turnkey travel system. I think that's going to be immediate revenue. Mm. You know, I think, as the story goes, Spark in New York City invested in them after meeting the CEO, you know, and talking to them for 4 days.
Yeah.
I don't think they were even raising money.
Okay.
And so, you know, I'd like to see companies like that continue to grow and take Barcelona as their home. You know, traditionally the corporate element was the ingredient that was missing here, mm-hmm. right? We have big global corporates, but they weren't so involved in the startup scene. We'd definitely like to see some attraction that will bring more talent to Barcelona. It will raise some of the salaries, which I think is important in the long run. You know, for the most part, we haven't seen one of the big kind of global tech giants put their stamp on Barcelona yet. So, so we'll see if we can.
We're missing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're missing kind of that. It's also a source of exit activity, you know, and a company that could possibly, you know, acquire some of these technologies that are being built here. Mm-hmm. I agree with what you're saying. I think it is, you know, your Champions League analogy is great. I think it's a city versus city type of contest here. It's not country to country. This is a global war for talent. And what we're seeing with the Brexit, what we're seeing with now the new leadership in the United States, you know, it's creating, you know, a lot of uncertainty in the investment world, and that creates a vacuum, and that's going to create opportunities for Europe, for Asia, for Africa, for South America too. That are, you know, investors are going to start looking elsewhere, because if it comes down to a war for talent, and you have two of the main epicenters of innovation closing their borders, well, you know, we're going to start looking elsewhere for attracting that talent.
Yeah.
I think Barcelona has a lot of the natural ingredients to attract that talent. If we can get some of the laws and regulations to let up, I think it will even help faster.
So how are you doing? What are you doing to try to, you know, soften up you know, the environment for corporates to come here, for more talent to come here? I guess this is your job.
Mm-hmm. It's part of our role. I mean, we are not responsible of everything, thanks God. And we try to put our piece on that. I think what is missing sometimes is a good PR campaign. When we travel around and we explain what is going on in Barcelona, there's still a lack of PR campaigns to see exactly how dense and how big is our ecosystem.
Mm-hmm.
We try to at least put a report in English once a year that we try to promote it as much as possible as a reference about what is the size and the type of ecosystem that we are managing. Something that helps with our acceleration programs in partnership with the Startup Bootcamp and NUMA. Last year, we were in more than 70 cities and more than 90 events recruiting startups from around Europe. We received more than 1,200 applications.
Right. Yeah.
Is that a good PR campaign? I don't know. This is what we do. And at the moment that we pitch startups to invite them to join to our accession programs is a way to explain to entrepreneurs from around Europe that something is going on and Barcelona is a good place to come and then run your business.
Yeah.
And if we get more resources and more bandwidth, if you want, instead of just be able to invite and invest in 20 projects per year, most probably we'll be able to reach 200.
Yeah.
Then our mission is be able to find the resources to be able to get these 200 in the city. And not just to bring talent, also to promote the talent that we have here. And I think 4 years from now, as Scott was remembering, first edition, it was 50 international, 50 national. So far, now we have almost all of the ecosystems coming. Mm-hmm. We have accelerator programs coming from LATAM, from US, from Asia. We are traveling with 4 years from now to Asia, to Israel. Mm-hmm. For the really first time this year, we're going to do an event in San Francisco.
All right.
That means that we are trying to create this type of interaction between mm-hmm. ecosystems, because at the end of the day, our message is clear.
Yeah.
Barcelona is a good place to run your business or to scale up your startup.
And for people that are on the ground, like working in the ecosystem every day, we know that the community here is quite fascinating, quite vibrant. It's growing a lot, and mm-hmm. people are very willing to help each other. It's very friendly, very welcoming. But mm-hmm. that's hard to show, you know, I guess, traveling around with 4 years from now banners. It's hard mm-hmm. to show that we have a great community.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of the people that are coming here are having a great time. And the people that are having success are a lot of them are local people. So in some ways, I don't know if it's true. It used to be a bit more like this, but we have like two camps maybe in Barcelona. You have like a lot of expats, and you have a lot of, you know, Catalan people that are having a lot of success. Mm-hmm. Do you think, Scott, it's necessary to try to, you know, merge these communities more than they are merged today to, you know, really boost, you know, mm-hmm. the PR of Barcelona?
Yeah, I think that's definitely a great goal and objective to have. But I think it's also happening naturally.
Yeah,
in the evolution of the last 3 to 4 years here, we've seen that kind of maybe oil and water starting to mix. You know, it's become more of a unified ecosystem, from what I can tell in the last few years. I think that will continue to happen. I think with the increasing, I mean, you were saying that Barcelona can always use PR. We can always use more PR, mm-hmm. but it's done a great job of promoting itself mm-hmm. as an innovation capital, as mm-hmm. a smart city world capital. The right. IoT World Congress is here. The yeah. obviously mm-hmm. the Mobile World Congress is here. Right. You know, so I think as that happens, more and more of the local and expat or international community will continue to merge. Like I said, we have all the ingredients. Before, we didn't really have a hub, but we're starting to build hubs now. You know, the Pier 1 is growing. There's a lot of, the, you know, I don't know, over 500 or so employees in that building.
1,000, I think.
1,000 now. So, yeah. So, I mean, it looks like it's going to even get bigger. Mm-hmm. That may be kind of a centerpiece magnet to try and create. But what we need now is events. We need content. We need socializing, you know, between those to create more synergies. And there's other events like Barcelona Global that does that more, not just for startups, but on a citywide basis. Their mission is to connect the globals, the Barcelona by birth versus Barcelona by choice. Mm-hmm. So some great initiatives that are doing that, and I think it's working.
Do you think? You're a local yourself, you know. Do you feel that? How do you think of the community when you think about it?
What I saw in the last 5 years is that, for example, a project like Scott is leading, like Barcino, 5 years ago, most probably will be something that will not succeed, or it will be even that doesn't make any sense. Nowadays, it's needed. If Barcino doesn't exist, most probably we'll need to invent it. We need something like is, for example, scouting, promoting the ecosystem in English, because it's the natural language if you want to get international. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what are the metrics of the people who are reading your newsletter and are following you. But for sure, there are people that is from Barcelona. Or that they are browsing or reading you from Barcelona because they are expats here, mm-hmm. that they are living in Barcelona and using your channel. And the other way around is something that sometimes I used to send it to someone mm-hmm. outside to mm-hmm. say, this is what is going on.
Yeah.
I think that the thing that has changed is that our startup ecosystem is becoming more global.
Mm-hmm.
We have 43 VCs putting money inside startups in Barcelona. If the founders or the team, they are not, if not experts proficient in English, international talent, facing international markets, they are not able to raise money from that business. Mm-hmm. That means that naturally, it's not just a question of appealing, of willingness to have expert friends, is that you need it as an employee.
Hmm. Yeah, it's true. And you
need to recruit that guys because you need to understand the culture of the country, of the expert that are coming here. You need the talent because maybe you are not able to recruit it here. Then it's just not just an appetite.
Hmm.
Right.
To get an international dinner and speak English. It's a must.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
When you are running a global startup, it's a must to have a multicultural, international project, especially when you are facing different type of markets.
Yeah. That's very interesting. And I'm thinking about, you're mentioning the English language several times here. And mm-hmm. we're in Spain, and Spain is a beautiful, great, huge language. But right now, English is the main business language of like the Western world, at least. Mm-hmm. We got to face it. Should everything in the Barcelona tech community be in English?
I think both. I mean, yes, English has to be a natural language, and everybody on the digital community has to be proficient or able to have, I don't know, in the right level of English to work mm-hmm. in English environment. But at the same time, we are Barcelona. And we don't need to, if you want to, delete our DNA.
Right.
And then I think that the beautiful piece of that is to be able to combine and coexist at the two sides.
Right. Exactly.
And when you go, for example, to Barcelona Tech City lunch, if you only speak English, you are welcome and you will be able to interact with almost anyone. At Pier 01, you will get into the lift and you see people speaking English or people speaking Catalan or speaking... What I say is that I don't know if the generation is the need of business, is everything together. I don't see that Barcelona that maybe time ago that people complain when they're arriving and, wow, if you don't speak Spanish or Catalan, you are not able to develop your professional career here. I think that at least on the startup scene, if you speak just English, even can be an advantage for you, depends on the moment of the project you're jumping in.
Right. Yeah.
What do you think, Scott?
Absolutely. I mean, I think even beyond just language, we have to appreciate the cultural differences, the backgrounds, because that diversity is what's actually going to bring value to the company, right? We're moving to an age where everything's moving faster and faster, and innovations are happening quicker, growth is happening faster. You know, if you look at companies like, let's say, you know, Facebook, it took, you know, let's say 10 years to reach 100 million users, you know, something like that. You know, well, Snapchat did it in two, right? You know, so we're moving faster. So what we need is to be able to solve problems quicker, and for that you need diversity. You need different cultural backgrounds, and so of course English is the language of international business. I think that will continue to grow, and it's necessary. But you also want to embrace the different things, and for speed and efficiency, if you're in Catalonia, you know, and there's two Catalan guys, they shouldn't be trying to communicate, you know, in English or in a, you know, in a second language if they can go things faster and not lose anything in translation. But in the end, the companies that do the best are the ones that have the most diversity, and they're the ones that are continue to thrive, I think.
Right. So we talked a lot about the great things in Barcelona, which there are a lot of, but there are things that are lacking as well. In your opinion, Aleix, what are we lacking when we compare ourselves, you know, to Berlin or Amsterdam or London? What do you think?
There are several things that, if you want, are related to Barcelona, or they are related to Spain as a general, because, for example, there are some tax environment that can be easily changed to make more efficient, for example, become a business angel and get a better tax relief when you are doing a business angel investment. Mm-hmm. That is something that it can be changed. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. For example, we can copycat what is going on UK, where if you became a business angel, you have a good tax relief on your personal tax at the end of the year. Right. That is something that I think is working well. Mm. It's already bulletproof that if you put that type of rules in place, it helps a lot. That is, if you want, on the business angel side. Mm-hmm. On the other is about stock options piece. I mean, nowadays, the way that the stock options are managed on the Spanish way is something that, if you want, is not really startup friendly. That is just to avoid taxes? No. Stock options is a really powerful tool to keep the talent engaged into your project. Sometimes the salaries you can offer in early stage startups are not the most competitive one if you compare to corporates. And the way to engage your team and be sure that they are fully committed to the project and they are not going to leave for a better salary is to offer them a stock option plan.
Exactly.
But the worst thing is that even I have a low salary, you give me stock options and now I have to pay taxes for the stock options I receive. Yeah. Then the business is horrible.
Yeah.
Or the sacrifice that they are asking for you, especially in early stage, that you don't know if that stock options ever in your life is going to make some money out of it.
Right.
That is not really startup friendly.
Yeah.
And I think that we need to design, if you want, a stock options, maybe related only to the startup space and not for the corporate space, that can be helpful for that.
Mm-hmm.
And especially when you go to international investors, the stock option plan is something that is asked. Because especially for the key people on the project, they really want to be sure that they are going to stay there for the next year and keep getting the product better right. and getting the startup to the next level.
Yeah.
That is something. The other is about visa. How easy is to land in Barcelona and get the permit to work, not just to visit, mm-hmm. because visit is quite simple. Mm-hmm. The other is how simple and how fast is the way to plug into Barcelona ecosystem and be able to get a visa to work.
Mm.
That, I think, always there is a room of improvement and it's something that maybe we can consider to do it better.
Right.
And the other is, if you want, the amount of space and the raising of the rental cost of apartments.
Mm.
If that trend that we see on this last year, it gets every time more and more strong, it can be talent adverse.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The fact that, yes, there are good projects in Barcelona, it's a nice place to live, but really expensive to stay there,
mm-hmm.
it can be something that makes more difficult for mm-hmm. entrepreneurs and founders getting the talent coming
definitely.
To Barcelona.
Right, right. Yeah. Scott, you have been you went to university in Boulder, like mm-hmm. a huge startup community in the mm-hmm. U.S., and also you started your first company in the West Coast in the U.S., where everything is happening, everything. And what do you think when you're comparing to other places, Barcelona?
I would agree with a lot of things, mm-hmm. Aleix, that I think the stock options issue and the exit tax that, mm-hmm. that's placed on mm-hmm. vested shares. So if you were to be an early employee or a co-founder and you were to leave Spain, you actually have to pay taxes on unrealized gains, mm-hmm. meaning you have to pay taxes on the current valuation of that,
yeah, exactly.
of your options. And you haven't even cashed out yet. So there are some adverse effects for the stock options, but I think that is something that could be easily fixed. The visa problem, I went through myself here. I did the entrepreneurship in residence. I'll be the first one to say it's not perfect. Mm-hmm. It's painful. It's time consuming. However, 3 years ago, it didn't exist. Mm-hmm. So I'm very grateful that it exists. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's as much as I might be cursing under my breath every time I have to go to the NIE office and I produce these these documents.
Yeah.
I'm grateful that it allows me to stay in Spain. And,
right.
and create a company in Spain, and so I think we're moving in the right direction, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's sometimes it feels like a slow battle, but we're getting there, right?
Mm-hmm.
That'll be crucial in attracting talent. Mm-hmm. We'll be opening up those opportunities. The other one is give the companies a runway, right? Reduce the subsidy, or, I mean, add subsidies, give incentives to hiring, make it easier to fire people. You know, make it so it's the first year or two in business isn't as painful as it is now, right? The autonomo fees are high. The SALAs, you have to start paying taxes, you know, revenue or, mm-hmm. or not. So, you know, I think that's one of the differences I've seen between the U.S. and you know, Spain or Europe in general is there's a lot more incentives and subsidies for early businesses, right? So what Spain does really well is they have a lot of grants and opportunities to get, you know, to get some extra funding on very good terms and rates with, you know, programs like ANISA or SEDETI. Mm-hmm. You know, I think these public-private partnerships are fantastic. They also invest in the fund of funds to spur innovation, so they'll create funds for VCs to tap into. So I think it's definitely you know, heading into a more favorable community. But even if you compare it to France has better incentives for early hiring than Spain does, and I think there's some great programs that could be implemented fairly easily here to boost early startup growth and create jobs. And,
right.
and that's what's happening. But I think we can even go faster.
Yeah, yeah. And you mentioned or Scott mentioned earlier that. We should have one of these big global companies come to Barcelona. Like that's one of the things we're lacking. Like a big Facebook or Google or the HQ of Airbnb or something like this. But do you think that you know, the state and the local government has had this clash with some of these companies, Uber, Airbnb? We're struggling a bit with some of these sharing economy platforms or collaborative economic mm-hmm. platforms. Is this something that we need to settle before mm-hmm. getting some of these bigger companies here, do you think, Aleix?
I mean, yes and not. I mean, I have my heart divide. I mean, if, I don't know, Facebook is landing in Barcelona with a big R&D department, if I was an entrepreneur, I would start to be worried. Because that most probably that will create is a lack of talent and the increase of the salary of developers. Then, I don't know, if suddenly Facebook is looking for 1,000 engineers in Barcelona and I'm running a startup, I don't know, in artificial intelligence, I will start to be concerned about if these guys are landing here, because most probably my engineers, some of them will resign, or if not, the salary of my engineers is going to increase.
Mm-hmm.
Then, yes, to come big corporates, especially the R&D departments, the ones that has value, all that. We need the tech guys from Facebook and Google. of course they are sexy and appealing to come. But with digital transformation, there are so many companies nowadays that we can consider non-tech, that they are looking for talent. Mm-hmm. That maybe that is for me a better bet, especially if we believe that we're going to be verticals at some point. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's better to get, I don't know, R&D and innovation or digital departments from Nestlé, as we have, or for fast-moving consumer goods, that we are able to get retailers focusing innovation on digital space in Barcelona, for example. Mm. That, for me, will be really much more a smart strategy.
Right.
Because we can create this pool of attraction. We have the startups on the retail e-commerce space, the investors that they understand that business, the talent that are coming to Barcelona because they know a lot about that, and the big guys on that space that they see that the digital strategy of them, yes or not, they need to need an antenna in Barcelona.
Yeah.
That, for me, will create the right ecosystem.
Right.
And about the second piece of your question about what we need to do regarding sharing economy, we need to take a step forward. I mean, nowadays we are at some point doing a regulation by no. That, I think, is on the short term. I think the what is needed is a deep discussion with all the people that is at some point will be affected. But no and ban things, I think, is a short-term reaction.
Right.
And what I would like to see is that, yes, on the meantime, we say no, because we need time to design what is the sharing economy landing in our city.
Mm-hmm.
But that type of thought and that type of work has to be done, mm-hmm. because at the end, the answer has to be yes, mm-hmm. but under that rules.
Right.
Now we are on the no. And I hope that on the next years, and not really far away, we're going to say yes, but that is the type of rules in Barcelona if you want to run your sharing economy business.
Exactly. So we're running a bit out of time, but to end it on a high note, we're in the beginning of a new year. So I just want to ask you, one company, like seed stage company in Barcelona, if you believe in one company, let us know, like give some PR to a cool company. So Aleix, if you would pick one company, like early stage company in Barcelona, to really prosper in 2017, who should we look for?
It's a tough question because we invest in 20 startups already and 41 on the last, and then I will say somebody that we have at some point some interest and conflict of interest. But if I don't say any of the ones that at some point we are supporting strongly, I say that Typeform, I really like this one.
Yeah.
I know that it's not really early stage, but it's this concept of B2B concept, and different. I really like this one.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you on Typeform. I think they did a great job planting their flag in Barcelona saying, we're going to stay. We're not going to raise money and leave. That was kind of the MO before.
Right.
They've made Barcelona their home, and they're probably the closest thing that I've seen in Barcelona to a Silicon Valley startup.
Yeah.
You know, the way the track they took to get to Series A, the investments they made in the city, the talent they've attracted, the office they built, and the way they operate. I think it's a great example of a post Series A success story here in Barcelona, and it'd be great to watch them grow right through to IPO possibly. You know, for early stage, there's some fantastic things happening in, you mentioned before, artificial intelligence, machine learning, computer vision. I like that space. I think there's a lot of PhD and research programs in Barcelona that we can take advantage of. And we're seeing a couple companies now coming up, you know, year one, year two. I'm going to be biased because I have two clients in this space. One is
Everybody's here. Biased. No real answers.
One is Compite. I think they're doing fantastic in the SaaS field. They have a proprietary technology that tracks your competitors in real time.
Mm-hmm.
Really, no one else can match their core, their technology in there. And now they just got into 500 startups in Silicon Valley, so they're getting accelerated kind of simultaneously here in Barcelona and San Francisco. The other one in artificial intelligence is bringing a solution for image recognition and machine learning to the real estate and auto industry. It's a company called RestB.ai, and RestB is competing head to head with companies like IBM Watson, with Google Vision.
Okay.
Amazon has an image recognition in these things, and they're going head to head. This is like five guys. They're going head to head, and they're winning market share, which is fantastic. So I think those are two names that you could probably watch in 2017 to really take some big steps forward.
Cool. All right, Aleix, Scott, thank you so much for coming. Pleasure having you both.
Thanks
here.
For having us. This is great.
Thanks.
This was the Itnik podcast. My name is Sindre Hopland. Be sure to check out the podcast on iTunes, on YouTube, on all the social channels of Itnik. Thank you.